Good morning. At the 1997 International Conference on Social Values, I had the privilege of presenting the Electronic Boardroom TMVI model for governing change, complexity, and risk. The emerging trends, critical issues, and pragmatic solutions, as published by the Oxford Center of Business and Educational Values, have become a boardroom industry standard, and they also have become an improvement roadmap. Since our best practices research is ongoing, during the informal think tanks, I would like to share our benchmark questionnaire and discuss your perspectives. When I first launched the model for boardroom change, some said nothing was broken and therefore nothing should be fixed. However, since then, debacles like the one that resulted in Enron's bankruptcy have proven that something was indeed broken. Some examples of priorities I mentioned then that are still relevant today are technologies for heightened security, information specialists on audit committees, crisis management and internet timeframes, employee complaints as an ethical lapse sign, and governance tools to manage change. In retrospect, topics that may have been viewed then as unrelated to core business, inappropriate for director levels, and clearly non-existent for budget purposes, have proven to now be part of urgent matters that affect you personally. CEOs, directors, advisors, investors, and pensioners face a big gap between proposed actions intended to restore confidence in this environment and the implementation of best practices, which must include non-financial factors. Clearly, there is an acknowledged need for objective, independent, and revised processes aimed at maximizing shareholder value. But how do we address this need? I reassert again today what I stated in 1992 when I created my registered trademark, and I said in 1997 here at Oxford, the TMVI framework and situation analysis tool works. It can track, assess, project, and manage strategic change. This tool enables the board to be a strategic asset of the company without interfering with management's role. So let's look at this approach to corporate governance. It is a pragmatic way to analyze the needs of a corporation and its board. I begin by focusing on the changing identity of the boardroom, how it must change to meet business needs. As we look at these issues, it is important to remember that the primary responsibility of the board is to maximize shareholder value. The board is the watchdog of the shareholders, and any deviation from this is simply unacceptable. Having said that, there are many instances where lines are blurred as one looks at social issues and ethics as they relate to shareholder value. In our consulting practice at Electronic Boardroom TMVI Solutions, we evaluate corporate needs according to four key factors which are reflected in our parent company's name, Technology Marketing Ventures, Inc. Let me walk you through each of these areas and demonstrate how they affect corporate governance. We begin with technology. Strategic systems designed to sell services, lower costs, create competitive advantage, enable just-in-time strategy, or protect important data are expensive. Therefore, they require board choices and sign-up. Boards who approve telecommuting, backup, and contingency plans as part of their Y2K conversion plans enabled companies to survive 9/11 effects. Boards that did not approve the funding for such plans found their companies without the foundation to recover operations after the disaster. Since disasters are inherent in a global, volatile, information-accessible world, IT issues need to be not only on the board's agenda, but on the board's top priority list. In order to prioritize, a board must understand the fundamental IT principle. Automation, information, and knowledge technologies must be aligned with strategic business goals. Without execution of this principle, a company will clearly fail to maximize shareholder value. Technology is as important an input to the business process as land, labor, and capital. It affects how a company monitors and reports its financial condition, directly relevant to shareholder value, how it administers and distributes its employee benefits program, a social values issue, how it produces and distributes products and services important to simply staying in business, and how much capital it will need to continually fund R&D and keep a company current. All of these issues affect long-term shareholder value. Technology advances affect all manner of corporate operations, shareholder reports, and capital expenditures. However, technology innovations occur much faster than their corresponding policy and regulations. A technologist understands the various issues surrounding change and the impact it will have throughout the corporation. Every board should have an ongoing relationship with a broad-based information technology consultant who can ask the right technological impact questions. Why? Because the electronic age has transformed data gathering, a process that is critical in helping boards monitor social and ethical issues, as well as perform fiduciary oversight. The audit committee needs an information specialist from the business community who understands the common language of data gathering and interpretive distribution. These are the keys to managing a diverse workforce in a global economy. Without a technology specialist in place, a board is ill-equipped to leverage events during this technology-driven era. Now, as I've just indicated, technology does not stand alone. And if you look at the name of our company, it's Technology and Marketing Ventures, Inc. That "and" is very important, because if in the analysis of corporate needs and directives, technology stands alone, then it's absolutely useless. In fact, technology serves operations, distribution, marketing, sales, the entire works. So when I say add a technology person to the board, I mean a person who clearly understands the interdependencies of all functional areas. Then that person can help the board identify real-world problems, create solutions to solve those problems, and finally actually implement those solutions in the real world. So where does board responsibility intersect with getting the product to market? Cause-related marketing programs increase awareness of a company, its products and services, and its social conscience and social values. Social values must be established in keeping with the first director mandate to protect shareholder value. If and when cause-related marketing can help the company achieve its business goals while it also promotes a corporate ethic, then the directors have achieved the ultimate objective. However, we must note that cause-related marketing does not absolve directors of ethical oversight. Enron has taught us that executives can still behave irresponsibly, even if they've donated millions and millions of dollars to education causes. We advise clients to look for some key signs of possible ethical lapses. 1, complaints from employees and/or customers. 2, insensitivity in downsizing and/or restructuring. 3, unjustifiable amounts for compensation and benefits. Remember that the corporate board remains the watchdog, and a sleeping dog offers no protection to shareholders or to anyone else. So, how does marketing strategy affect governance? In a successful business, marketing strategy must be focused on the customer. The board must understand who the customer is and what the company is selling. Then the strategic plan stays focused on the core business, which affects technology, mergers, acquisitions, sales, and by the way, contributes to a very appropriate selection for a cause-related marketing program. So in addition to the information advisor on the board being a business person with broad-based technology skills, the person must have a working knowledge of marketing operations. Then the information advisor can help the board directors understand the risks that are inherent in joint ventures or mergers by asking questions like, do the information systems being used by the various entities communicate efficiently? If not, what's it going to take to make them communicate? Can the business support that kind of expenditure? What are the risks if they do not mesh? These issues hold as much fundamental importance as the more traditional considerations of expanding markets and capturing market share. Before venturing, the board must have all the information. How do we analyze boards in terms of ventures? Ventures are defined as endeavors, speculations, investments, and risks. These are all appropriate definitions. Joint ventures hold great promise and great risk for businesses. The promise includes expanding markets, products and services, efficiencies, and expertise. The risks include ethical lapses that cause liability concerns and mismanagement resulting from poor communication. Because joint ventures are increasingly initiated at the business unit level, the corporate board needs to set the tone and values to be assessed for each joint venture opportunity. Then, when a venture opportunity presents itself, a business unit is empowered from the very top as to how the corporation evaluates and consummates business opportunities. Now, what do we mean by Inc.? We mean incorporating all of the business issues into the business of the boardroom. Again, the key business of the boardroom is to protect and maximize shareholder value, to foster the long-term success of the corporation, and to set standards that aid this goal. The board faces complex and sometimes competing responsibilities. Monitor compliance with legal and regulatory requirements, produce fiduciary oversight, maintain close ethical scrutiny, and keep the stock price rising, but protect the stakeholders. These are tall orders, but not impossible ones. I would like to take a close look at one issue that today's boards must embrace if they are to succeed for the future. An issue that embraces social values but also clearly encompasses business principles. I consider lifetime employability versus lifetime employment a critical social values issue. This is not a separate concept that was born in a boardroom and is limited to business hours. Besides affecting corporate organizations and management, it involves personal and interpersonal skills. And the employability issue transcends all traditional boundaries. So for example, in borderless cyberspace, nobody knows whether you graduated from Oxford, nobody knows what your race is, nobody knows what your gender is, or even what time it is. Thus, technology is not just changing products, machines, or devices, it is affecting a cultural change. It requires getting educated in fundamentally different ways and in fundamentally different social behaviors. Moreover, this education is not just for technocrats. It is for overseers as well. Overseers must be aware that the internet also acts as a marketing distribution channel and a venture with many diverse partners. That means boards may have to tackle head-on the tough social and legal concerns that emerge from troubling issues such as illegal activities, intellectual property, safety, privacy. These issues also present exciting opportunities for new types of companies and services, but may require employees with different skill sets to immediately serve the market. No. Companies cannot promise lifetime employment, but with a commitment to constant training and education, companies may be able to guarantee lifetime employability.